professors and the students who live there spend their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. I paraphrase a verse we read this morning because it is a very apt description of MIT. I have been at MIT all my adult life. I arrived in Cambridge, Massachusetts more than 42 years ago and have pretty much never left. Today I title my talk, New Wineskins. And I would like to start by revisiting something that we have seen yesterday. It's only 20 years since the World Wide Web was invented. During that time, we have seen phenomenal growth. Today, more than 1 in 3 people uses the internet actively. In developing regions like Saudi Arabia or Middle East or Africa, the growth rate is 20 or 30-fold in the last 10 years. Today, there are almost as many cell phone subscriptions as there are people on Earth. Users and uses of applications, social media applications like Facebook or Instagram or Twitter, is measured by the hundreds of million, billion, and even trillion. For a whole generation of young people, the way they learn, communicate, and socialize is being rapidly and radically changed. About a dozen years ago, at the height of the dot-com bubble, many of our peer universities were positioning themselves to profit from the knowledge that the universities hold on to commercialize them through the internet. And some at MIT were advocating that we do the same. I was then the Associate Dean of Engineering, the number 2 person running the school at that time. To me, that was a sort of a Esther 414 opportunity. And after doing a very careful study, we were able to convince MIT to launch the MIT OpenCourseWare project. The idea was simple. We would go 180 degrees the other way. We will publish all our materials, all our course content on the internet, and make it available to anyone in the world, open and for free. As a Christian, I had kingdom reasons for wanting MIT to do that. But as a professional, it was important that the project made sense for MIT. And indeed, it should be good for MIT in a deeper and truer way. OCW makes sense for MIT because MIT's core values, are impact, leadership, and excellence. Impact, because MIT can and should be able to influence and impact people in far greater numbers and far beyond the few thousand we have within our Ivy walls. Leadership, because at that time, no other major organization had done anything like that. And MIT can set an example. And excellence, because there is nothing more powerful than excellence, than openness to achieving excellence. Once convinced, MIT and an overwhelming number of my faculty colleagues, in fact, more than 90% eventually, embraced the OpenCourseWare idea. Today, OCW had published MIT's entire undergraduate and graduate curriculum, more than 2,000 courses covering every degree program we offer in every academic department. Lecture notes, assignments, exams, syllabi, reading materials, video lectures, complete video lecture simulations in many courses, tools, and sometimes textbooks that are public completely online for free. More than 100 million students, self-learners, and educators from every continent and country have used MIT OCW. In order to help some regions not to have to pay internet tariffs that goes over the oceans, 300 mirror sites in more than 76 countries were established. OCW has been translated to Chinese, Spanish, many, many languages. We did set an example. Eventually, more than 300 other institutions worldwide form a consortium, OpenCourseWare Consortium, that today offer more than 20,000 courses. We received many testimonials, and we did case studies of how OCW was used. I give you some example. This is a student, secondary student from India, using OCW to augment what he is learning in school to do better in school. A university student from Nigeria. Two entrepreneurs from Haiti who were developing solar power streetlights for some of Haiti's poorest communities, and they were using OCW so that they can figure out how to do it well and cheaply. In fact, they could have all the information at their fingertips for them to achieve that. A secondary teacher from Malaysia using it for the class. Here's a picture of the class. University student from Pakistan. Professor from Guatemala. A secondary student from Sierra Leone. We received many, many supporting emails, thousands, hundreds of thousands. And a colleague of mine whimsically collected some of these, and many of them are off the top. I like words like Eighth Wonder or Big Bang. My personal favorite is like falling in love. In fact, OCW was informally nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize more than a dozen times. From the foundation of OCW by MIT and all these other institutions, we have now been brought closer to realizing a vision. The vision is that high-quality educational content, teaching, and certification will one day be accessible to not just the select and privileged few, but to everyone, anyone, everywhere, who is willing to learn. In recent years, there have been now the formation of what we call MOOCs, massively open online courses that had literally banded all of the leading elite universities worldwide in edX, Coursera, Udacity, and so forth. The question I want to ask to end is to spend a couple minutes to think about how these ideas, these kind of developments, might be exploited for the kingdom and its purposes. How can we leverage these technologies for the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the building up of his body? Thinking creatively about new approaches and models, exchanging our present comfort zones and methods where necessary for future kingdom gains. I offer some simple and perhaps simplistic ideas. After all, I really am not a professional in any way in this audience, but I hope they might seed some conversations. Consider a consortium of existing institutions creating a global virtual seminary, offering fully online or hybrid versions of content, instructions, certifications, and even degrees. I like to use these pictures because I just made them up so that you can get a picture of how this institution might be reaching this guy on the mountaintop trying to get a degree in theology. Many are already moving towards these goals. I quickly did some examples, and these logos are places that are beginning to think about or have done extensive, very thought-provoking studies about the possibility of doing that. Well, why stop there? Why not do an iSeek, interactive websites in local languages, offering non-intimidating, seeker-friendly space? It's so non-intimidating because they don't even have to shake the hand of the person. For the non-Christian, perhaps in a remote or hard-to-reach place, to find resources, to hear or read or watch testimonies, to have their questions answered, and to interact with other seekers and Christians. Well, don't stop there. How about I gather a site for Christians who could be socially or physically isolated? Perhaps they are doing an experiment in Antarctica. To meet, pray, encourage, advise, admonish, and fellowship with other believers. Again, there are examples. I show some logos. How about iChurch? I'm not sure. It seems very radical. An interactive virtual place that serves functions of the local physical church. Today, we have mega churches in North America that are already doing that in a way because they are using closed circuit broadcasting in a different building or in a satellite church. Well, why should it be in a satellite church? Why not be under a banyan tree somewhere? Many people could then benefit from that preaching or learning or prayer or worship, encouragement, admonishment, discipleship, fellowship, mentoring, perhaps even sacraments. seems very radical. I thought they were very radical until I met a bunch of Christians on campus. And they say, what do you mean? We do that all the time. You worship together? I personally have never felt the Spirit move other than in a real physical place. They say, we do that all the time. Jesus says, where two or three are gathered in his name, they gather on the internet and they feel his presence in their midst. I would not challenge them. But there are many questions to solve, issues. What about authenticity? Real testimonies? What about tangible love and support? We heard about real relationships yesterday. Could we exercise accountability in this way? Are there any oversights or control? Some people argue that because it is global, in fact, you could have more oversight. So I want to conclude by asking, how should we respond to all this that has happening? Some of the, just in the last 5, 10, certainly less than 20 years. These are great opportunities for the church, challenging us to really get together, to consider wisely, creatively, prayerfully, and then act. There are, of course, risks, perhaps great risks, for doing some of these. But I submit that the greater risk is that we might do nothing and miss the opportunity to powerfully carry the gospel of Jesus Christ to a new generation in new wineskins. Thank you.